Good evening. We would like to extend a very warm welcome to all our guests at the launch of Navigating the Labyrinth, Perspectives on India's Higher Education by Devesh Kapoor and Pratap Bhanu Mehta. Demographic changes, economic growth, integration into the global economy, rising demand for higher education, an increase in the number of private colleges, all of these has led to massive expansion of higher education in India. In fact, in India, few things open faster than colleges. And yet fewer sectors reform more slowly than higher education. This expansion of higher education comes with a fair share of challenges, such as access to, cost, and governance of higher education. Most importantly, the question of quality of higher education. These issues are closely connected with the question of employability of the youth in India. Navigating the Labyrinth combines diverse methodologies, such as ethnographies, case studies, data-based work, to portray this varied landscape of higher education in India. And this exercise has been undertaken by two very well-known academics, Devesh Kapoor and Pratap Bhanu Mehta, and their colleagues. There is very little one can say by way of introduction about them that could be considered adequate. But still very briefly, Devesh Kapoor is director of the University of Pennsylvania's Center for the Advanced Study of India. He is professor of political science at UPenn and the Madanlal Sopthi Professor for the Study of Contemporary India. Prior to arriving at Penn, Professor Kapoor was associate professor of government at the University of Texas at Austin and the Frederick Danziger Associate Professor of Government at Harvard. Pratap Bhanu Mehta is the president and chief executive of the Center for Policy Research. He is a political scientist who has taught at Harvard University, Jawaharlal Nehru University, and the New York University School of Law. Dr. Mehta has served on many central government committees, including India's National Security Advisory Board, the Prime Minister of India's National Knowledge Commission, and a Supreme Court-appointed committee on elections in Indian universities. It is a pleasure having you here with us, Professor Kapoor. Dr. Mehta, welcome. We also have an enviable panel with us this evening to discuss the volume, and I welcome each one of them. Anubha Bhosle is executive editor at CNN News 18. She is an award-winning journalist and reports on politics, gender, and development. She is also the author of the book, Mother, Where's My Country? Pankaj Chandra is the Vice Chancellor and Chairman, Board of Management, Ahmedabad University. He has taught at McGill University in Montreal, University of Geneva, the Wharton School, University of Pennsylvania, International University of Japan, Cornell, Renmin University, Beijing, and IIM Ahmedabad. Professor Chandra has served as a member of the Government of India Committee on Clusters for Development of the Informal Sector. He was a member of the Government of India Committee on Rejuvenation of Higher Education, or the Yashpal Committee. And he was with the Committee of the Autonomy of Central Institutions. Apurvanand Jha is Professor, Department of Hindi, University of Delhi. Professor Jha was part of the core group that designed the National Curriculum Framework for School Education in 2005. And was a member of the National Focus Group on Teaching of Indian Languages, formed by the National Council for Education, Research and Training, NCERT. He has worked with the committee to advise on renovation and rejuvenation of higher education in India under the chairmanship of Professor Yashpal. He also regularly writes on issues of education, culture, communalism, violence, and human rights. Orion Black Swan would like to thank all of you for being present with us today to discuss this book. May I now request Anubha Bhosle to take this evening's program forward, please, with an introduction and a discussion on the book.
Thank you so much. Thank you. You know, I think in some ways, the events of the last few days that have happened here in Delhi University sort of deeply intersect this conversation, and I think there'll be no getting away from that. And while that remains a lens that I want to bring into this conversation, there are deep structural challenges as far as Indian higher education are concerned, and the authors have, in this collection and in other places, called it the trilemma, in a sense, and that, in a sense, is going to be our focus here this evening. I'm going to engage with these gentlemen for about 45 to 50 minutes, and we'll leave the floor open for conversation. Pratap, do you want to sort of start it off by putting out a broad overview of what this collection has?
Good afternoon. Thank you all for being here. I know 4 o'clock is not the most convenient time, and I think it's a testament to your commitment to higher education and to us, I think, that you are here. So deeply appreciate it. I just also like to begin with two preliminary remarks. First, a big thank you to Orient Black Swan, and particularly Rupa, Pratiti, Kunal, Mimi, everybody associated with the book for actually bringing it out under somewhat difficult circumstances, given non-cooperative editors and authors. Thank you. Thank you so much. And a big thank you to all our contributors who have waited unduly long to see their work in print. I think the division of labor between Devesh and me is Devesh proposes great ideas and I basically slow him down. So the delay is as it were on me. The idea behind the book was relatively straightforward, which was to get a set of perspectives on higher education in India. The idea is not to produce a kind of comprehensive tectonic, architectural survey of higher education in India. In fact, I think one of the sensibilities that informs this conversation is those kinds of enterprises tend to be much more quixotic and assume a lot more omnipotence and omniscience in central planners than is good for any system of higher education. What we instead decided to do was just sort of, look at different slices, as it were, of the kind of higher education landscape. And just to, in 2 minutes, just kind of just run through, because most of you haven't had a chance to read the book. And the idea of this conversation is not to kind of talk about the chapters per se, but just use this as an excuse to have a collective conversation about higher education. And we're so delighted that Anubha has kind of chosen to lead this conversation. So it begins with a wonderful chapter by Apurvanand, which is really a story of two colleges in Bihar, Patna College and Sivan College, very historically very important colleges. But through that, it asks very powerful questions of not just, as it were, how, in a sense, institutions evolve and decay, but some very deep and profound questions about what humanities actually means. And it's one of the few chapters in the book that kind of reverses the question. When we talk about the creation of human capital, the idea is that human capital is created for something. This, in a sense, reverses the gaze and says, okay, what do we create for human beings, right? A kind of non-instrumental conception of education. Then there's a wonderful chapter by Sachi Tekanai, who couldn't be here. She has incredible comparative experience on sort of research universities, and it's really asking the question, what does it take to get a multidisciplinary research university going? What are India's strengths and weaknesses in this area, and how does one think about design of this universities, and particularly, again, cautions against thinking about top-down models. Then we shift focus to Manish Sabharwal's and Srinivasan Krishnan's paper, which really focuses on, as an institution, it focuses on the institution of a community college as a institution that can possibly fill a gap in Indian higher education, both in terms of the populations it reaches, but also in terms of the kinds of the substantive curriculum it imparts. But it really is a fascinating discussion about how to think of community colleges not just as vocational educations, but really as kind of civic institutions in a broader sense. Then there's a wonderful chapter by Megha Bari, who's here, that begins with the starting point that 90% of India is in the informal and unorganized sector. And what are the institutional and regulatory mechanisms that one needs to think about in an education framework that actually addresses them? Then there's an interesting chapter by Jimal Unni on basically the supply-demand mismatch in higher education, which is a very detailed statistical analysis of what are the kinds of degrees for which there has been demand and what are the kinds of degrees which have been kind of in excess supply. K.P. Krishnan has a very detailed empirical chapter on education financing and probably very unique data on basically who avails of loans in higher education and what does that tell us about that as an instrument of financing. Devesh and Madhav Khosla have a chapter on basically the courts as regulators. It's both a conceptual study of the way in which courts have framed what higher education actually means for us, particularly this category that, you know, higher education has to be non-profit. What regulatory implications does this have? But it's also an empirical study of the actual kind of litigation that comes to courts, right? And that allows courts to actually become regulators. And one of the not surprising things is that basically courts seem to, even rights-based legislation is really about administrative interference in university systems. And then Pankaj has a kind of wide-ranging tour de horizon on sort of governance debates in universities. So the idea was to sort of, as I said, you know, capture different snapshots. We are deeply grateful for the authors for providing what we think are unique and new insights into the subject. And even though there's been some delay in publication and the whole world has changed, you know, it seems to change every 6 months, with I think the global debate also on higher education now acquiring new and different dimensions, we are deeply grateful to all of you to contribute. Over to Anubha.
Thanks so much, Pratap. Devesh, let's start with you. And I think I want to sort of start at the very basic. I think there's little disagreement in a sense that India needs to do much more when it comes to higher education. But irrespective of the scale and the magnitude of the problem, I think what sort of starkly stands out for me is that this is an issue that hardly agitates public opinion. You know, considering education, higher education, primary education, even kindergarten, sort of it occupies the mind space of the Indian parent from every strata of society.
I think one of the puzzles that we sort of grapple with, but frankly, without an answer, is why is it that every single political party in India, it doesn't matter if you're the right, left, a caste-based regional party, cares so little about higher education. Even when parents and citizens clearly care so much about it. I mean, one of the things I think we try and show is that every single political party, for decades, it's nothing new, despite the recent sort of attention, the destruction of higher education institutions began from the late 60s, you know, with the state universities. Now it may be extending to central universities, but it's something which is long-standing. This is not new at all. And why no political party, regional or otherwise, has sought to think in a more forward-looking way. It's particularly striking because you could ask that, look, the only thing that India really has an excess of is people. And so the only thing that we can really do going forward is to deeply invest and build in human capital, because we really don't have a surfeit of natural resources or other forms of wealth. And this is the one form of wealth creation in your own people that should be a fairly obvious thing for political parties and a broad political consensus. And frankly, you know, we don't have an answer. I mean, we sort of speculate, you know, the right in general has had a pretty strong anti-intellectual agenda. The left, as we saw in places like West Bengal, killed higher education by totally trying to control it with their cadres. And the caste-based parties in UP, etc., saw higher education as the bastion of upper caste social and cultural capital. So to undermine that base in the 80s, 90s, that had to be basically taken out. But even otherwise, I mean, we have something on something very simple on higher education, which is veterinary colleges. It occurs in no one's mind to actually think about that, as because we all think of IITs, IIMs as the only thing of higher education. Now, we have about 1 billion farm animals in the country. We produce about 1,500 to 2,000 veterinarians a year, roughly one per half million farm animals. And yet every political party shouts hoarsely about doing all this for the farmer, the poor, for rural development. But the very complete basis, and you know, if you ask the question in UP and Bihar, where you've had Mulayam or Lalu Yadav, you know, these parties, their social base is among social groups where cattle matters a lot for their well-being. So you would have thought, even if you destroy every other higher education, at least invest in veterinary colleges, because you have a clear self-interest there. And even there, the imagination is so singularly, you know, lacking.
So what explains this mismatch priority?
I must confess, having been working on this, I really do not know the answer in a way that I would like my colleagues to speculate on this. Why, across the board, it's been such a self-destructive sort of attitude towards higher education.
I just want to push that further, and perhaps I'll get Pankaj to weigh in that as well. When we were often talking about the Indian IT revolution, its genesis was often seen that you have these huge number of programmers and engineers, etc. But when one looked at it deeply, you found most of these weren't actually trained by conventional universities. At the same time, you have this situation where you have a high demand for engineering education in this country when domain jobs are so very less. So I think I come back to the question, where do you place this mismatch? Either of you could weigh in on it.
So this example that you gave of the IT folks, actually what the industry was largely looking for was skills. And I think this is probably where we may have gone a little bit off kilter too. When education started to expand in 60s and 70s, we expanded so rapidly that and with large number of people, you had to standardize everything in order to manage both the learning processes as well as the certification process. And as soon as you do that, then you're standardizing learning, standardizing everything else. So what matters at that point of time are not specific variations in your abilities, but whether you've learned the fundamental principles. And that's what engineering turned out to be. At the end of the day, when in close to 2000, when Y2K happened and the industry was starting to grow, you had a large number of people who were ready with some quantitative analytical skills, and that's just about it. You were getting from mining engineering to electrical engineering, everybody who was getting into the IT sector, and none of them probably knew programming. So I think we reduced the entire, and that success led to a bit more phenomenal damage. And it's not 2000 alone, it's been happening for a while. And we just started to see education only as a provision of skills. And I think to your first question, what happened to the society, to Devesh, I think the society started to see education only in terms of their own benefit. So imagine how many of us would worry about a Delhi university or any other university once your kids have graduated from there. That immediate beneficiary, as soon as that focus or that gaze moved away from us, the university was a nice place and you had nice memories of that place. That's just about it. So was the government, so was the industry, and all of them were converging on the skill story. But the world was much larger. That citizenship, love for learning, all of that had vanished for a while.
Can I just and answer your previous question? So one of the things which we show in the book, which I think might partially answer what you said, higher education is big business. It's a fundamental thing that we should understand. Between 2000 and 2014, India opened 5 new colleges every day, including weekends. This is the single biggest expansion of higher education ever in the world. At its peak of expansion of higher education in the United States, which is the early 1960s, one new college was opening every week. So we were opening it at a rate 35 times that of the United States at its peak. And the United States in the 60s was a much richer country than us. In the 1980s, enrollments were growing by about 0.1 million. In the last decade, they've been growing at the rate of 2 million a year. Higher education, if you look at the government reports on black money, education sector after real estate, according to estimates, internal estimates of the government, both previous and this, is the sector with the highest amount of black money. It is the sector in which most politicians, any politicians worth their salt, has a stake in a college or set of colleges or very large number of colleges across, you know, states sort of in India. And I think this thing of higher education being an activity of making, you know, money, where the regulator, so to give you an example, in Andhra Pradesh now, a big part of the higher education budget actually goes to pay the fees as fees subvention for students to go to the very colleges owned by the very politicians who are passing the budget. I mean, it is a beautiful scheme. I mean, even Donald Trump would be proud of it. And that is what this has now become.
You know, but what is it about the regulatory mechanism that allows so much of the dubious institutes to mushroom, but makes it so very tough for an institution of repute, for an institution? I mean, surely there could be some examples of that.
That would take a few days.
I think briefly to answer. I think that's what hinted his book, and you know, I think the previous work that everybody on this panel has done is, I think you have two sets of contradictory forces conspiring, and as always, kind of the extremes converge. So one is the story Devesh has told, which is that at some point, the political economy of private higher education got entrenched in a way in which the incentives of the regulatory system are to keep good players out, and not just keep good players out, but to actually frankly destroy public universities. I mean, if your 400 public universities had been doing half of what they could do, even with the resources they had, the market for these private players would be sort of tougher, right? So because we expanded so rapidly, and under the guise of that rapid expansion, we said, well, we need private capital to do it. And certainly, I mean, that privatization at one level, particularly in professional schools, allowed you to churn out these graduates. It created an entrenched political economy, which is actually not going to, in a sense, allow, right, genuine education entrepreneurs to win, because, right, so that's one part of the story. The other side of the story, which I think is much more entrenched and psychologically subtler and harder to deal with, is the good guys in this story. So one of the things you see, right, with our regulatory framework, and this is really at the level of principle. I mean, once you concede that principle, everything else actually follows. So in the name of accountability, right, accountability almost always produces counterproductive results, actually, more and more. So the demand for accountability in a system that was corrupt and deeply hierarchical essentially produces a regulatory system where the regulators have inordinate powers. Sure. The suspicion of any form of discretion being exercised on behalf of education, right? And at one level, education is, pedagogy is about discretion. It's about the variability across the mean. It's about understanding your students. A suspicion that these structures are so riddled either with inequities of power or they will be abused led to an extraordinary standardization, right, of almost everything, right? I mean, the Supreme Court judgment in the Chhattisgarh case, you know, calling for
I mean, the standardization and homogenization of Indian higher education, right? But, you know, the pressure was that because we are so suspicious of discretionary power. The suspicion of diversity. This idea that different institutions can have different identities, they can have different missions, right? Some institution will say, I'm happy educating 60,000 students in a standardized skill-based framework. Some education saying, you know, we'll educate 200-300 students very intensively. That suspicion of diversity, right? And as I said, it comes from this desire to produce accountability. And finally, and I think this is something, you know, it's kind of been hard to sort of conceptualize in different ways, which is once the pressure for accountability, the suspicion of diversity, all of this stacked up to a confusion around one basic question. If you ask today, who has the right to define the identity of a particular institution of higher education? Let's say if JNU says, we want to be a world beater and this is what we think it means. If IIT wants to make the decision whether we become MIT or whether we educate 100,000 students, whose decision is it? Who are the stakeholders? So your governance structures are such that within each institution, the question of the identity of that institution has now become not only deeply politicized and contested, but in ways in which there's no actually resolution of taking it forward, right? And I'll end with this Delhi University, right? When the debate over the four-year degree was happening, what was striking about it was not, you know, whether you do 4 years or 3 years. What was striking about it, here's an institution that's saying, we want to be a top research university. We want to be a top four-year degree college. By the way, we also want to be a polytechnic. By the way, we also want to be a skills and vocational place, right? Now, whose decision is this, right? So that question, I don't think in the Indian governance structure has been answered.
I'll take it to Professor Poonam, just one second. Let me get in Pankaj. I mean, so in that sense, what makes an institution so very vulnerable? The lack of infrastructure, the lack of resources, the political interference to it, this confusion about what an institution should be, its own identity, as Pratap is saying. But how does one circumvent that? How does one go forward from there?
I think one piece which changed somewhere over the last 70 years was the role of the regulator. The regulator in very early years of 20th century higher education in India provided a very broad framework and then allowed institutions to operate a little bit, just like Pratap is saying, within it. And then they started to define, and that's where you saw in 1910, 1920, 1930s, there were several colleges of the kind that Apurvanand has written in his chapter, spring all over the country. And the key feature there was the regulator had the nose in and hands out. Today it's just the opposite. They have the nose in and hands in also. So they're eating the pie in quite some ways. Now the question is, so what do you do to get out of it? And there are very many layers, right? So you have the regulator, and then you have the governance of the institution, and that's gone amok. What's happening inside is also really out of control in quite some ways. And then you have the larger environment. I think the easiest thing to address would be the regulator. Because it's the structure.
Would not be the governance structure of the institution itself.
So governance structure of the institution is in many ways a response to the regulation that exists. And in quite some ways, if the regulator kind of walks away a little bit and gives that kind of space which is needed for the so-called good governed institutions to kind of go and run with it, I think that might create a change.
You know, Pankaj, what makes the governance of an Indian higher education institution so very different from governing anything else?
Okay, so I think Universities are very complex organizations, not only in India, but everywhere in the world. You should ask vice chancellors globally, and they'll tell you, you know, that after being a VC, I get diabetes, cholesterol, and blood pressure. All three of them, three medals, you know, as Pratap keeps saying all the time. So they are because they're socio-cultural organizations. They're not bureaucratic structures, they're not commercial organizations, they're social organizations, they're cultural organizations. And managing them is all about managing people. And as soon as you get your gaze out of people and focus on structures, focus on incentives, rules, regulations, I think we tend to then lose the emphasis in it. And that's what, because educational institutions are run on the principles of trust, phenomenal trust. I don't think there's any leader in an organization who can manage by saying, tomorrow morning you're going to all come at 8:30. So the fundamental piece in there is trust, a respect for others' views, and adequate amount of space to operate within them. Once that's done, and that's protected, and it's also a safe place. A university is a safe place. As soon as that safety vanishes, I think the whole governance keeps coming crumbling down. And there are many players who violate it. The external environment is impacting the safety. The leadership impacts safety. The teaching community are affecting safety. And of course, the regulator. And many of these actions are a response to those of the regulator.
You know, and I think that unlayers so many threads, but I'll leave some of it for later. I want to bring in Professor Purnanand. You know, I have to say, I've never had an education abroad, and recently I had, and one of the things that struck out for me, which I found was greatly resonated in your chapter, was how colleges intertwine so very much with the ethos of a city. You know, how the city feeds into a college, how the college feeds, or how a university feeds back into the city. You know, you've spoken about this sort of robustness of those two colleges, a very healthy environment, and perhaps I think it's unfair to ask you to point where it all started to wane. But in the examples that you've chosen of the two colleges, in those stories, what do you believe, where was the start of the decline?
وہ ہندوستانی زبانوں میں نہیں دی جاتی ہے اور اس وجہ سے آپ جب یہ سوال کرتے ہیں کہ سماج اس سے کیوں الگ محسوس کرتا ہے تو اس کا ایک جواب یہ ہے کہ ہندوستانی سماج کا لگاؤ اس کے اچھ شکشہ سنستانوں سے نہیں کے برابر ہے کیونکہ اسے یہ نہیں معلوم کہ آپ کیا کر رہے ہیں اور اس وجہ سے اب جو کہ راشتروات کی بحث اتنی زیادہ چھڑ گئی ہے تو جن لوگوں نے راشتروات پہ کتابیں لکھی ہیں وہ چاہے رومیلا تھاپر ہوں یا باقی تمام لوگ ہوں انہیں یہ سمجھ میں نہیں آتا کہ ہماری بات لوگ سمجھ کیوں نہیں رہے ہیں لیکن کبھی بھی اس زبان میں جس کو اس دیش کی جنتا جانتی ہے اور میں صرف ہندی کی بات نہیں کر رہا ہوں میں بھارتی بھاشاؤں کی بات کر رہا ہوں ان میں ہم نے نہ سدھانت بنانے کی کوشش کی نہ ان میں ہم نے شکشا دینے کی کوشش کی اور اس کے بعد اب ہماری شکایت یہ ہے کہ اس دیش کی جنتا جھنڈا اونچا رہے ہمارا جیسا گیت تو سمجھتی ہے لیکن جن گن من نہیں سمجھتی ہے کیوں نہیں سمجھتی ہے یہ بہت بہت بڑی درگھٹنا ہے جو ہندوستانی اچھ شکشا کے کھیتر میں ہو گئی ہے اور یہ لگاتار بڑھتی جا رہی ہے کیونکہ ہم نے یہ مان لیا ہے کہ انگریزی ایک آسان زبان ہے اور اس لیے جب شکشا ویوستھا کے بھیتر کے لوگ خود کو ہی پیدا کرتے جاتے ہیں بار بار تو اس میں کوئی محنت نہیں کرنی پڑتی ہے کیونکہ آپ جب ہندوستانی زبانوں میں اتریں گے تو آپ کو کافی محنت کرنی پڑے گی وہ چاہے راجنیتی شاستر ہو یا سماج شاستر ہو یا بھوگول ہو یا منوگیان ہو تو یہ ایک ہے لیکن دوسری بات جو آپ کہہ رہی ہیں اس میں پنکج اور دیویش اور پرتاپ اس بات کو اٹھا چکے ہیں کہ دراصل شکشا سنستھان کالج یا یونیورسٹی ایک ساماجک سانسکرتک سنگٹھن ہے اور ان کا رشت उनसे समाज उस प्रकार का एक आत्मीय रिश्ता बनाए रखना चाहता है, लेकिन दूसरी तरफ यह भी होता है कि उन जगहों पे कब्जा करने की कोशिश, यानी उस सांस्कृतिक स्थान पर अगर आपका कब्जा पूरा हो गया तो फिर समाज पर आपका कब्जा पूरा हो गया। यह बात मैंने सिवान में देखी, वह व्यक्ति आज तिहाड़ जेल में है, लेकिन मैंने ये देखा कि सिवान पर उसका कब्जा तब तक पूरा नहीं हुआ था जब तक डीएवी कॉलेज के परिसर में वो अपना दरबार नहीं लगाने लगा। तो डीएवी कॉलेज के कैंपस में जब उस सांसद का दरबार लगने लगा तो सिवान पर कब्जा उसका पूरा हो गया। और यही चीज़ आप रामजस कॉलेज में देख रहे हैं, या यही चीज़ आप जवाहरलाल नेहरू विश्वविद्यालय में देख रहे हैं, या दिल्ली विश्वविद्यालय, इसमें मुझे थोड़ी भी हैरानी नहीं होती कि एक बार आप इस सांस्कृतिक जगह पे अपना वर्चस्व या अपना कब्जा पूरा कर लेंगे तो समाज पर कब्जा पूरा हो जाएगा। और ये इस वजह से है कि एक शुरुआती इज्जत की भावना समाज में थी, वो उसको नहीं पता था कि यहाँ क्या हो रहा है, जैसा हमारे कुछ दोस्त कहते हैं इन जगहों पे क्या हो रहा है, लेकिन उसको भरोसा था कि कुछ हो रहा है जो हमारे भले के लिए है, ये एक बहुत बड़ा भरोसा था और उस वजह से इज्जत थी। लेकिन वह चीज मेरी अपनी समझ में, मैं जितना समझ पाया हूं, 60 के दशक के बीच से टूटना शुरू हो गई। भारतीय राजनीति में जिस तरह के परिवर्तन हुए और प्रतिनिधित्व की राजनीति शुरू हुई, और उसने कैंपस में, मैं ये नहीं कह रहा हूं कि वो गलत था या सही था, लेकिन उससे जो चीज हुई, और खासकर मैं देवेश से बार बार कहता रहा हूं कि 1974 के छात्र आंदोलन को मैं बहुत बड़ा मोड़ मानता हूं, जिसमें जयप्रकाश नारायण ने यह सोचा कि यह शायद आज़ादी के आंदोलन का एक दूसरा क्षण है, जब महात्मा गांधी ने कहा था कि आप बहिष्कार कीजिए और उसी तरह मुझे कैंपसेस का इस्तेमाल करना चाहिए, और उसके जवाब में इंदिरा गांधी ने कैंपसेस को कहा कि, जब उन्होंने कहा बहिष्कार कीजिए, तो कांग्रेस ने कहा कि आप आइए और इम्तहान दीजिए और आपको किसी तरह की मुश्किल पेश नहीं आएगी। तो 1974 मेरे ख्याल में एक बहुत बड़ा मोड़ है जिस पर बहुत ध्यान नहीं दिया गया है, जिसका अध्ययन नहीं किया गया है, और उस पर हमें ध्यान देना चाहिए, ये मेरी अपनी समझ है। लेकिन शहर और शिक्षा संस्थान का रिश्ता, मसलन रामजस कॉलेज और दिल्ली का क्या रिश्ता है, या जवाहरलाल नेहरू विश्वविद्यालय और दिल्ली का क्या रिश्ता है? मुनीर का, आज सुबह ही हम लोग जवाहरलाल नेहरू विश्वविद्यालय में बैठ कर बात कर रहे थे उच्च शिक्षा पर, और यह बात प्रोफेसर रामास्वामी ने पूछी कि आपने जिन जगहों पे ये विश्वविद्यालय बनाए हैं उन जगहों को वापस ये विश्वविद्यालय क्या दे रहे हैं, या ये बात बहुत पहले प्रोफेसर उपेंद्र बख्शी ने अपने एक व्याख्यान में कही थी जब वो साउथ गुजरात यूनिवर्सिटी का जिक्र कर रहे थे, उसके एक्ट का, और उन्होंने कहा कि हमारे यहाँ ये मसला उठा कि आदिवासी अपने जानवर यूनिवर्सिटी कैंपस से होकर नहीं ले जा सकते हैं, और यह मसला जब उठा तो प्रोफेसर बख्शी ने एक्ट उठाकर देखा ओरिजिनल, और उससे यह पता चला कि यह जगह दरअसल आदिवासियों की जगह थी, और एक समझौता था कि आदिवासियों को वापस विश्वविद्यालय कुछ देगा, और आज यह कहा जा रहा था कि नहीं, आदिवासियों को उस पूरे कैंपस से बाहर कर दिया जाए। तो एक स्तर पर अब यह बहुत पेचीदा हो गया है, क्योंकि मेरी समझ यह है कि समाज को अपने आप को विश्वविद्यालय से अलग रखना चाहिए। विश्वविद्यालय से वो अपेक्षा कर सकता है, लेकिन विश्वविद्यालय पर वो हावी नहीं हो सकता, कॉलेज पर वो हावी नहीं हो सकता। अपनी मांगे वो कॉलेज या समाज से, विश्वविद्यालय से नहीं कह सकता कि आप पूरी करें हमारी मांगे। यह एक दूरी का रिश्ता समाज और विश्वविद्यालय के बीच में होना ही चाहिए, यानी विश्वविद्यालय एक ऐसी जगह होगी ही जिस पर समाज का दबाव नहीं होगा। लेकिन यह बात हम पूरी तरह से भूल चुके हैं, यानी हमारे राजनीतिक दल भूल गए हैं, हमारे बाकी संगठन भूल चुके हैं, और वो अपनी सारी समाज की मांगें विश्वविद्यालय के भीतर पूरी करना चाहते हैं, जो मेरे ख्याल में संभव नहीं है।
It is very hard to better Purvanand's analysis of these things. And I would really urge you to read his paper. You don't have to read anything else in the book, but just his paper, which is one of the most beautiful and most heart heart, like rending sort of just the story of what happened to these colleges. You cannot capture the tragedy of Indian higher education in any way better than the way he's, you know, written it out. I think what he alludes to is something sort of around the world or in the US, UK, it's called the town-gown relationship. But one thing which is interesting, what he said was, you know, when you look at in the US or UK, two other places we sort of know a little bit about, which is the election of Trump or the election of, or, you know, Brexit. And what you see is how much wider societies actually now have a deep suspicion of experts and universities. You know, everyone said, all the experts in British, Oxford, Cambridge, and you go around, you talk, they just could not believe that people would vote for Brexit. Absolutely. And they were completely taken by surprise when that happened. Same thing, you go to the Harvards, Princeton, they had zero chances that Trump would be elected. Completely taken by surprise. And this sort of dissonance between wider society and the university is not unique to us. It is more acute in our case, perhaps, but is not unique to us. I think Pratap also might have something to say on this.
No, just a couple of small points. So one, you know, so fundamentally, one way of thinking about this relationship, you can think about it spatially, right? The relationship between university and city. But in terms of its relationship to society, the standard claim or authority of education was this is the site for the mitigation of social inequality, right? That whatever else education might do, it does not reproduce the same structures of inequality that exist outside society. This is, I mean, you know, our answers to most questions is usually education, inequality, education, equality of opportunity, education, development, education, right? Now, I think the interesting question to ask is what are the conditions under which societies get convinced that that is the function their education systems are performing? I think as Devesh rightly pointed out, it is a history worth going back to, you know, mid to late 19th century, there was a serious debate in the United States whether Harvard should be nationalized. There was, because there was the sense that it reproduces social inequality and it does not position US as at the cutting edge of a knowledge revolution. So neither of those functions it performs. And, you know, then there was a first great wave of American university governance reform, you know, which in 20, 30 years transformed the American university system. That social capital kind of continued to be sustained, particularly because of World War II, the GI Bill, I mean, all of those things, right? And it's not an accident. I mean, you know, Angus Deaton just wrote this piece yesterday in Times Higher Education Supplement, basically arguing the same thing, that universities are no longer seen as bulwarks against the reproduction of social equality. They've now become the principal instruments of reproducing it, right? So I think that broad relationship between university and society, and linguistic inequality is one aspect of it. I mean, I think in India, the visible markers of it, now, the big success the Indian public system had was it did become a socially inclusive space in one respect. I mean, that you cannot take away from the Indian public university system, you know, other than politics, it's the only space where, you know, at least there's enough distribution of different, right? What we did with that inclusion, as a moment of opportunity, that's a different story, right? But I think we shouldn't take it for granted that it's self-evident in all times and all places that universities are considered good things, that they're considered socially legitimate. That's a very, very contingent and hard-won achievement. And I think, to be fair, when the history of higher education is written, Indian higher education, it has to be said that our abdication as a community is a bigger story in this than the political story. I mean, the politicians kind of came in when the vacuum sort of happened. And one of the things points Pankaj makes in this chapter is, you know, we can talk about all the rules and regulatory reforms that you want, this structure of committee, that structure of committee, not having a politician on the committee. At the end of the day, right, our abdication in that process of thinking about what a university means, what we are doing pedagogically, the only thing we, I mean, in university teachers' unions, The only thing we never discuss is actually the pedagogy and pedagogical goals of the university. We solve every problem in the world from Russia to Palestine, but not that.
Take that in, the sort of the self-abdication of the academia.
One of the things that the academics in many of our institutions is supposed to play a role is that of a gatekeeper. No. And gatekeeper of many kinds. The society saw academic institutions as an ideas place. And that it lived to it for quite some period of time. But the world outside was also changing. And the world outside wanted these institutions to essentially be also agents of change externally into the society than only through their own students. And of course, there's a relationship between what you do inside versus what you do outside. And that's where this breaking down of university as an ivory tower started to happen at many places. And there's a very interesting, I think Saatchi's chapter has a very interesting 2x2 matrix of relevance and effort. And one of them, which is called the Pascal's quadrant, is the one where institutions are doing high research and at the same time high relevance. Hmm. That part somewhere vanished. Or either in many of our institutions, we were just not able to maybe give roots to it adequately that it could grow. And this is really where the academics should have played a very different kind of a role. And I come back to the regulator a little bit, because at one level we can say, the academics should have prevented this so-called decay from happening, the so-called influence of outside from happening, but it was actually the regulation which was forcing this as well. So give you an example. Who selects a vice chancellor? Okay. The vice chancellor is selected by people who have nothing to do with the university. These are folks who don't know the university. They don't know what is the challenge that particular university at that particular location and that context of time is facing. Hence, this is the right kind of profile of a person who will make actually the best vice chancellor. Because the committee comprises of people who are sitting outside. Several years ago, there was a situation when vice chancellor of 14 central universities were decided at another center like this very close by over a 2-hour long meeting, not even visiting the institution for which you are searching the vice chancellor. So it was that which now created a waterfall of, in quite some ways, where suddenly the floodgates opened, very different kind of people came in, all of them gave up their role as gatekeepers to the fort, and of course you had an army moving in.
I think add to the thing of the abdication of academics themselves on the governance is actually the role of the professions. So if you take law or medicine, we actually in the 50s had created under statutory acts of parliament, the Bar Council of India, the Medical Council of India, Pharmacy Council of India, the Dental Council of India, the Institute for Architecture, all the professions, statutory bodies. There is, forget the UGC or AICT, which are the usual sort of villains among the regulators. But here was actually something that the politicians, parliament had passed, that look, the professions should be self-governing, right? Which is what you want. And you look at how the leadership of the Bar Council or the Medical Council, what it has done to the professions themselves. The irony is that if you look at the professions of, say, chartered accountancy, cost accounting companies, these are one of the only professions where there's no university. And they are the ones that have actually kept some standards. The ones, because
the professions were supposed to do really safeguard and create standards and said, look, this is the body of knowledge we believe someone who is going to practice a dentist should have, right? That was sort of, because they are the experts, they know their field, they know the advances. At some point of time, 80s onwards, they began to get into the business of granting approval for new colleges, which is where the money was made. Which is why the whole elections to capture these bodies began to change. Because if you are a real expert with, you know, in medicine, you were not going to spend a lot of money trying to buy votes, which literally began to happen. And I think the failure of the professions to self-govern has been a huge part of this problem, which has added to the problems which the other regulators have.
Should I also?
Yes, please, sir.
एक समस्या तो यह रही है कि खुद शिक्षक या अध्यापक खुद को एक प्रोफेशनल की तरह देखते नहीं हैं। दिल्ली विश्वविद्यालय में मैंने यह महसूस किया कि एक अध्यापक की कौन सी पहचान उसके लिए सबसे महत्वपूर्ण है। अगर आप दिल्ली विश्वविद्यालय में जाएंगी तो आपको ये पता आप ये पता कर सकती हैं कि ये साहब राजनीति शास्त्र पढ़ाते हैं या ये बॉटनी पढ़ाते हैं, लेकिन उसके साथ आपको ये भी पता चलेगा कि ये DTF के हैं या ये NDTF के हैं या ये AAD के हैं। और इस पहचान को इतना ज़्यादा प्रमुख बना दिया गया है कि उसके अध्यापक की पहचान सबसे पीछे चली गई। और यह समस्या हमने जब 4 साल के स्नातक स्तर के पाठ्यक्रम की बहस चल रही थी उसमें सबसे अधिक महसूस की, क्योंकि वह बहस पेशे के आधार पर नहीं हो रही थी, पाठ्यक्रम की दृढ़ता है उसके आधार पर नहीं हो रही थी। देखा यह जा रहा था कि कौन सा फैक्शन कितने ज़्यादा लोगों को ले सकता है। तो आप एक यूनिवर्सिटी में प्रवेश करते हैं, आप एक विश्वविद्यालय में प्रवेश करते हैं और आपका सामना एक शिक्षक से नहीं होता है, आपका सामना एक DTF मेंबर से होता है या आपका सामना एक AAD मेंबर से होता है, CPM एफिलिएटेड टीचर विंग या BJP एफिलिएटेड टीचर विंग या कांग्रेस एफिलिएटेड टीचर विंग के सदस्य के रूप में होता है। इस रूप में अपना परिचय देने में जब शिक्षक गर्व का अनुभव करने लगे तो मुझे लगता है दुर्घटना हो चुकी है और उससे उबरना बहुत मुश्किल होगा। इसलिए दिल्ली विश्वविद्यालय में जब हाल में ये घटनाएं होने लगी जिन घटनाओं का हम जिक्र कर रहे हैं, तो होना क्या चाहिए था? अगर एक अध्यापक को सड़क पर पटक कर मारा गया 15 बार, है ना, उसकी पसली तोड़ दी गई, तो हम यह अनुभव करते हैं कि सारे शिक्षकों को सड़क पर आ जाना चाहिए था कम से कम। लेकिन हुआ क्या, यह देखा गया कि अच्छा, जो शिक्षक पीटा गया है वो वामपंथी था, इसलिए दक्षिणपंथी शिक्षकों ने दूसरे दिन काम यह किया कि फ्री द कैंपस फ्रॉम रेड टेरर कैंपेन उन्होंने शुरू किया। तो हमारी कोई प्रोफेशनल एफिनिटी एक दूसरे से नहीं है, कोई लिहाज नहीं है। जो चीज़ मैं सिवान DAV कॉलेज के अपने किस्से में बताता हूँ कि वह थी, उस वक्त हम कम से कम एक पेशेवर रिश्ता महसूस करते थे, वह चीज़ अब पूरी तरह से टूट गई है। और चूंकि विश्वविद्यालय का सामूहिक जीवन छिन्न भिन्न हो चुका है इन स्थितियों में, तो हम कक्षाओं में किस रूप में जा रहे हैं, छात्रों के सामने किस रूप में जा रहे हैं, हम अपना शोध कार्य किस रूप में कर रहे हैं। तो यह एक बहुत बड़ी दुर्घटना है जो भारत के विश्वविद्यालयों के साथ हो चुकी है। वरना मेरी समझ में यह नहीं आता कि अगर हरियाणा केंद्रीय विश्वविद्यालय में एक युवा अध्यापिका महाश्वेता देवी की कहानी पर एक नाटक करती है और उसके चलते उसको चारों तरफ से धमकियां मिलती हैं और वो नौजवान लड़की है जिसकी पूरी पढ़ाई लिखाई हरियाणा में हुई है, कहीं बाहर नहीं, JNU की नहीं और कहीं और जगह की नहीं, लेकिन उसके विश्वविद्यालय से एक भी अध्यापक उसके लिए खड़ा नहीं हो पाता है। जोधपुर विश्वविद्यालय में एक भी अध्यापक राष्ट्रीय राणावत के लिए खड़ा नहीं हो पाता है। तो यह जो अब हो गया है शिक्षकों के पेशे के साथ, इस पर भी हम लोगों को बात करनी चाहिए कि हम अपने आप को अध्यापक के तौर पर अब देख ही नहीं रहे हैं, हम विचारधाराओं के प्रतिनिधि के रूप में खुद को देख रहे हैं। और हमें खुशी होती है अगर एक दूसरा अध्यापक पीटा जाता है या उसको जलील किया जाता है या उसको निलंबित किया जाता है या बर्खास्त किया जाता है, तो हमें खुशी होती है और हम चाहते हैं कि वो बर्बाद हो जाए पूरी तरह से।
You wrote in one of the pieces about this particular incident about Professor Ranawat. Isi ke maddenazar, you know, Professor Ranawat in a sense went out of what many would consider her job profile to set up
that particular seminar to call in Nivedita Menon, to also call in people from other ideologies. Aaj ek adhyapak, aaj ek professor, ye kyun karna chahega?
मतलब विडंबना यह है कि यह हमारे पेशे का हिस्सा है, सेमिनार करना हमारे, यह हमारे पेशे का हिस्सा है. इंटरडिसिप्लिनरी अप्रोच की बात बहुत ज़्यादा की जाती है. राजश्री राणा ने किया क्या था, अंग्रेज़ी पढ़ाती हैं लेकिन उन्होंने राजनीति शास्त्र, समाज शास्त्र और दूसरी विद्याओं, साहित्य, तमाम तरह के लोगों को राष्ट्र की समस्या पर विचार करने के लिए बुलाया. ये हमारा काम है अध्यापक के तौर पर. दुर्भाग्य से पिछले कुछ वर्षों से जो प्रचारित किया जा रहा है कि आपका काम है सिर्फ और सिर्फ सिलेबस के भीतर रहना, और जिसकी बात शुरू में हो चुकी कि वह सिलेबस भी वह होगा जो यूनिफॉर्म होगा. तो अब क्या हालत है जिस पर समाज का कोई व्यक्ति नहीं बोल रहा है? सारे लोग ये बोलते हैं कि 250 सबसे ऊंचे के विश्वविद्यालय में हम कोई नहीं हैं, लेकिन ओपिट पीसेस लिखने वाले हमारे जितने बुद्धिजीवी हैं उनमें से किसी ने नहीं पूछा कि भैया तुमने पूरे भारत पर एक यूनिफॉर्म करिकुलम कैसे लागू कर दिया सीबीसीएस के तहत? कैसे तुमने ये किया कि हर विश्वविद्यालय को तुम बोलोगे कि ये 80% है जो हम दे रहे हैं यूजीसी से बनाकर, 20% अपना ले लो. तो करिकुलम की क्या समझ है, 80% 20%? ऑटोनॉमी की क्या समझ है, अध्यापकों की क्या समझ है? आप ये कह रहे हैं कि यूजीसी में बैठ कर चार लोग पूरे भारत के हर विश्वविद्यालय के सिलेबस बनाएंगे? तो हमारा जो काम है हम वह काम कर रहे हैं. राजश्री वह काम कर रही थी. अब राजश्री को यह कहा जा रहा है कि तुम अपनी सीमा से आगे बढ़ के क्यों कर रही थी काम? तुम आराम से जी सकती थी. तुम्हें क्या जरूरत थी आफत अपने सर पे मोल लेने की, जैसे स्नेहसता से कहा जा रहा है जी. और अब ये तय मान लीजिए कि हरियाणा केंद्रीय विश्वविद्यालय में तो कोई कुछ नहीं करने जा रहा है, बिहार में कोई कुछ करने नहीं जा रहा है, और कहीं भी कोई कुछ करने नहीं जा रहा है. लेकिन जो लोग, मैं सिर्फ इस सरकार की बात नहीं कर रहा हूँ, जो लोग विकास का इतना ज़्यादा जलसा मना रहे हैं और जश्न मना रहे हैं, उनको इन दुर्घटनाओं की तरफ ध्यान देने की फुर्सत नहीं है. और यह हरियाणा है, बिहार है, हिमाचल है, छोटी छोटी जगह हैं, इन पर जो छात्र आ रहे हैं वो सब लगभग उन्हीं इलाकों के हैं. इनको ये पहला मौका मिल रहा है एक्सपोजर का, और अब आप क्या कर रहे हैं कि नहीं, बिल्कुल ही नहीं, क्योंकि ये सब कुछ संदिग्ध है. जो कुछ भी मेट्रोपॉलिटन यूनिवर्सिटीज में हो रहा है वह संदिग्ध है, और इसलिए आपको हिंदी में जो कुंजियां बनाई गई हैं उन कुंजियों से अपना काम चला लेना चाहिए.
So this is
that, yeah.
I think there's a related question here, and the question is, what is our imagination of the university? What is this place? Is this a place where everybody kind of like a primary school comes in, walks in line, the teacher stands up, says, okay, today's lecture is this, 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 I'll teach you multiplication, and then I kind of do that, and I go out, write an exam, and everybody's fine. The parents are extremely happy, my kid got 93%, and the teachers are happy. I mean, is that the imagination of the university? And I think there was a time when the society, and hence the regulator, had a very nuanced view of education. I think that part has been bludgeoned very, very strongly. And we need to recreate this imagination, because the academic is much, much broader. In Gujarat in 2002, when the riots were taking place, we were at IIM Ahmedabad. I was teaching there. We were right at the gate, standing lots of students and faculty. And here's a group of people pushing you back and saying, "Aapko yahan bheja hai padhane ke liye." Now, is that our imagination? And it's not that we were even standing and protesting. That's a business school story. That's a different one. But somewhere or the other, the role of the university and the academic is much, much larger than the things that happen just in the classroom.
I think before I open it up for questions, let's just take final remarks from you, Pratap and Devesh. I mean, let's not end on such a somber note, at least this panel. I mean, what should the imagination of a robust public university
So I'll just end with this thought, right? Here's the paradox of contemporary India, right? Which is, if you look at the demand side, I'm not pessimistic. You know, you look at young people, you know, you just look at the hunger, right? For ideas, for debates. I mean, you know, you can go to now small town literary festivals and have people turn up. Now, we can actually joke about that as a phenomenon. But to me, it is expressing the fact that there is actually a demand and a hunger for a much deeper and richer conversation. And this, I will still say, I still find it hard to believe. I've been out of the university system for a long time, so maybe I'm just wishful thinking. Whenever teachers have taken students seriously, students have not let you down. That, I think, is the challenge is that the institutional structures through which we are trying to meet this demand are so ossified, right, that they are in a sense not capitalizing on this, you know, opportunity. And which is why a lot of the interesting conversations are happening in all kinds of unexpected ways, not in the classroom, you know, outside. And that conversation is, I mean, you know, we can say, look, yes, the media is problematic, all of that. But it is still surprising how much of that conversation is actually happening in all kinds of places. Small towns, I mean, first generation, you know, for whom it's the first opportunity, right, in a sense, to access this. What they have been let down is not their commitment or demand. What they have been let down by is these structures that do not know how to talk to them or how to respond to them.
You know, talked about first generation university goers. बहुत दिलचस्प है कि ठीक जिस वक्त उन्होंने प्रवेश करना शुरू किया, उसी वक्त ये सारा सिलेबस या करिकुलम को यूनिफॉर्म बनाना और उसमें प्रयोगों की संभावना को ख़त्म करना, या मैं पिछले 20 साल की बात कर रहा हूँ, मैं किसी इस 3 साल की बात नहीं कर रहा हूँ, यानी जिसको प्रताप कह रहे थे कि विश्वविद्यालय एक ऐसी जगह मानी जाती थी जहां समाज की गैर बराबरी को दोहराया नहीं जाएगा या फिर से पैदा नहीं किया जाएगा, और वह एक अभी भी एकमात्र जगह है जहां जो पहली पीढ़ी के पढ़ने वाले हैं वो आते हैं इस उम्मीद के साथ कि वे ऊपर चढ़ेंगे, वही एक जगह है। लेकिन ठीक इसी समय जो रिसोर्सेज हैं, जो साधन हैं, उनको कमज़ोर से कमज़ोर किया जा रहा है। यह मैं पिछले 20 साल की बात कर रहा हूँ, राज्यों की बात भी कर रहा हूँ, क्योंकि राज्यों का दावा यह है कि हमारा अधिकार है उच्च शिक्षा पर, और इसलिए आप केंद्र से न बताएं कि क्या करना है। लेकिन अगर आप राज्य में चले जाएं, वो चाहे तमिलनाडु हो, अभी हाल में पश्चिम बंगाल सरकार ने जो एक्ट जारी किया है, आप उस एक्ट को पढ़ लीजिए और उसके बाद आप सर धुनिएगा कि वो एक्ट क्या करने वाला है वहाँ की यूनिवर्सिटीज़ के साथ और कॉलेजेस के साथ। तो यह ठीक इसी समय मैं कह रहा हूँ कि यह जब मौका है इन सब के लिए पब्लिक यूनिवर्सिटी सिस्टम में जाकर उसको क्लेम करने का, उस चीज़ को, ठीक उसी समय उसको पूरी तरह से तोड़ दिया जा रहा है। माफ़ कीजिएगा, आप इस नोट पे नहीं इस बातचीत को यहाँ ख़त्म करना चाहती थी, लेकिन ये
जस्ट सो वन इज़ यू नो आई हैव टू से आई एम वेरी पेसिमिस्टिक अबाउट the future of the public university, at least of now. I am not pessimistic about learning of young people. I want to separate these two. You know, there was a small news item when Jayalalitha passed away, and you know, there was all this thing, who's going to be the leader of AIDMK? What is interesting is all of the vice chancellors of Tamil Nadu went to pay their respects to Sasikala. Now imagine, she's not elected.
Issued a statement.
Huh? You know, now you can imagine the self-abnegation that you're a vice chancellor of a university. This is a completely unelected, has no locus standi. But of course, they are seeing the future. Now, we're not saying that to be a vice chancellor, you have to pay XYZ amount of money. Obviously, these things would never happen in our country. but you could speculate, right? But I think the one thing I do see is The brick and mortar university, which was the classic locus standi of what a university was about, you know, the places of like learning, is, I think that frankly is going to be very hard for us to replicate at the scale of higher education that it exists now of 35 million students. I just don't see that happening other than very few places. But I do see young people now have resources which my generation never had. You know, if I just see, we've been working on MOOCs, which is massive open online courses, Coursera. The second largest demand worldwide is by young people from India. We followed their IP addresses. We've done, you've seen these surveys. So people are learning not because of the system, but despite the system. And that is, I think, the saving grace. The options outside the traditional structures are much greater than in the past. It is, of course, a great pity, because when you go to a university, it's not just about what you learn in the classroom. It's about socialization skills. It's about learning to deal with peers from very different backgrounds. And you could argue that one of the great contributions of our universities till the 60s, it is where we created Indians. I mean, I went to, I did my engineering at, you know, BHU. And I'd gone to an alumni. We had a big thing in San Francisco a few months ago. And the head of the Alumni Association, he had come from Chennai, he was from Chennai originally. And he said one thing which really struck. He said, I came to BHU as a Madrasi, I left as an Indian. And that was the sort of peer group effect of meeting people from all outside, from all different backgrounds, which you can't do through electronic learning, you know, which you can't get access to the best teachers. But that social learning is much less.
Do you think in the university exists today where you can come in as a Madrasi and go out as an Indian?
I will allow the audience.
Okay. Should we open it up for questions?
Yes.
Please, sir, go ahead. I think we'll be able to hear you. I think.
Medical, history, geography, economics, everything. And today, I have got a problem at my 74 years. I had registered myself in IGNU University. Of course, I have left it because they don't recognize now. My topic was role of professional ethics in construction projects. Now, this ethics is a philosophy, construction and engineering. There is nobody in this country to have this match of these two things. And in USA, I have simply heard that they say you take art, science, history, geography, statistics, everything. No problem can be solved if you have got one dimension of economics, one dimension of philosophy. So basic question is, the whole structure of higher education in India should be multi-part university, first. And second is there any necessity of universities at all? In this country, we require fundamentally earning to feed our belly. And that thing possibly is necessary. I asked Dr. Chidambaram, I'm making little, you allow me this thing. He's a Prime Minister Principal Advisor in TIFAC. I said, sir, who will be more good for our country than the abandoned boy and girls who shows magic on the road every day, and the police and all these things, and the fat boy of a very rich man who paying huge donations get the reservation in the nursery before birth. Well, that is not that way. It's a very, your question is very simple, answer is not simple. I said, what? Domain knowledge. Today, domain knowledge is free. So question is, why do you have, and you know, in foreign countries, Steve Jobs and others left this, going to the colleges, because why should I waste my father's money and my time? So question is, today we should make people to go to the basic fundamental thing and able to create things so that they can do something good for the society, book the country, and also
his own. Fair enough, sir. I'll get you to pause there now. Okay, let me just take in 2-3 more and then we can get the panelists once. Go ahead.
The mic,
I'll request your no problem, sir. I'll request your questions to be short, please.
Meaningful discussion. Now what Apurvanand was trying to say about the role of the teacher, and if we relate it to the politicization of education, we do find that the teachers themselves are trying, as you also mentioned, teachers are themselves taking a great pride, reporting to the politicians every evening and coming back feeling more confident. That is one thing. The second is that we need to redefine
the role of the teachers. Is it to be, what does it mean to be a professional? Getting better and better every day in our subject area, and also the interdisciplinary aspect, also the transdisciplinary. Or is it to just get in touch with the students, take the technology to the classrooms, and try to get over-dependent on it, and never try to look into the eyes of the students whether the curriculum that is being transacted is being, you know, taken by the students or not. My third worry is, I'm sorry, I'm just going to finish, the large number of students are getting 90% that you were talking about, 98% and even 99%. The colleges, the best of colleges, have no spaces. And therefore, the issue that was just taken up, that colleges, universities are opening up every day, which is going to compromise the quality and obviously the professionals that we will have. So one needs to look at ways how we can check this and become more meaningful in transaction of what we need to do. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
I have
a question. One more question.
I have the microphone here.
Oh, sorry, sir.
That's
please,
right.
Go ahead.
My name is Francisco Marmolejo, and I'm the global coordinator of the higher education of the World Bank. I am based in Delhi since 6 months ago, so my question is based on the wisdom of ignorance about higher education in India. You know, it's a fascinating system of higher education. That's my general observation. And for that matter, this book, I'm sure that it will help a lot to understand the complexities of such a diverse system of higher education. So I have two basic questions for the panelists. One is that, the first one is that something that is really shocking is to see how India has I might say, the most diverse and fragmented system of higher education in the world. You know, 39,000 higher education institutions is much more than the 3,000 higher education institutions that China has, with a relatively similar size of enrollment. So I'm curious to know the reaction of the panel to that, to that shocking number, and what are the implications that has for sort of the harmonious development of the higher education system in India. And the second one is, hopefully the panelists also can react to the new plans of the government to support world-class universities, which on a way it's a legitimate interest and aspiration that every country should have. But secondly, what happens if some of the decisions are made also kind of sacrificing the resources for the other 39,000 higher education institutions, which won't be world-class universities. So I wonder if there is an opportunity to react to this.
Should we start the answering, Divish? Divish, you want to take on the gentleman first?
I mean, this is just, I have a paper with a colleague from Harvard who works on China, comparing higher education in China and India. And one of the things we observe is the point that you made, is that the higher education system in India is much more fragmented than in China. But it was not the case. China also had a very high fragmented system. But what the Chinese Communist Party did, which cannot occur in India, they forced a merger of many of them and cut down the number of institutions very sharply. That's how that happened. In India, the expansion has occurred for a range of reasons. One of the reasons is it's a land grab for a range of people. You get land access, and once you get the land access, after 10, 15 years, it might close down, and by that time, you can change the use of the land. The degree, you know, to which the Chinese Communist Party has seen higher education as fundamental to China's future as a great power is something that is completely absent in the debates in Indian higher education. It's completely delinked. So for them, you had this project 211, which is, you know, we're going to put all our resources on 100 institutions. Then they had this project 985, which is to say we'll focus all our resources on 9 institutions, which they've expanded to 34 others. So all of that is saying, you know, we're going to concentrate our resources on a few institutions. Easier to do it in an authoritarian top-down system. Here it is very decentralized, and what you're saying is not going to happen. The tragedy is, of course, when you have that fragmented a system, you just have no faculty. You know, when you have few faculty, so even, you know, we've opened all these new IITs and IIMs. You know, the idea should have been to get students to come to the few good places and expand them, rather than to create tens of other institutions with only 400, 500 students. You'll never get the number of concentrated faculty to really build a sort of deep, proper institution. So I'm afraid to your answer, it's not going to happen.
I'm not going to let the panelists answer your question about government's plans for world-class institution. We'll keep that for the end. Do you want to tackle her question about the role of the teacher, Professor?
उसके बारे में हम बात कर चुके हैं, लेकिन मैं सिर्फ यह कहना चाहता हूँ, देवेश ने जो बात शुरू की थी, एक चीज़ जो हिंदुस्तान के विश्वविद्यालयों के साथ हो रही है, वह है उनका कस्बाईकरण, प्रोविंशलाइजेशन. पहले विश्वविद्यालय में आने का मतलब था एक कॉस्मोपॉलिटन जगह में जाना, और हर विश्वविद्यालय की यही समझते हैं. आप पटना यूनिवर्सिटी को देख लें, BHU को देख लें, इलाहाबाद यूनिवर्सिटी को देख लें, या कलकत्ता यूनिवर्सिटी को देख लें, किसी को, उसके शिक्षकों की आबादी को देखिए. लेकिन अब आप देख लीजिए, इन सारी जगहों पे वे सिकुड़ कर अपने कस्बे के आसपास रह गए. जो 15 नए केंद्रीय विश्वविद्यालय खोले गए, वो सब के सब लगभग कस्बाई विश्वविद्यालय बन गए, क्योंकि उनमें छात्र लगभग वहीं के हैं, और आमतौर पर जो शिक्षक आ रहे हैं अब वो घट के उसी के आसपास की जगह के रह गए हैं. तो विश्वविद्यालय में पहले इस बात की संभावना थी कि हम अपनी सीमा से बाहर जाएंगे, हम लोगों से जुड़ेंगे, एक ट्रांसेंडेंस की पॉसिबिलिटी थी. लेकिन अब प्रताप ने जहाँ से बात शुरू की थी उसके ठीक उल्टा हो रहा है कि आप जो विभेद समाज में थे, उन विभेदों को आप विश्वविद्यालय में दूसरे ढंग से पैदा कर रहे हैं, यानी एसोसिएशंस और अलग अलग तरह के संगठन. इसलिए जब मैं दिल्ली विश्वविद्यालय के कैंपस में जाता हूँ और मैं देखता हूँ कि अच्छा, ये है जो नागा छात्रों का समूह है, ये है जो मणिपुरी छात्रों का समूह है, ये है जो मैं जानता हूँ पहाड़ी छात्रों का समूह है, ये है जो बिहारी, और उसमें भी हमारे पिछले कुलपति ने बताया कि भूमिहार छात्रों का समूह है या शिक्षकों का समूह है. तो मैंने दिल्ली विश्वविद्यालय को 4 साल पहले पहली बार भूमिहार नाम के तत्व का सामना हुआ, और लेकिन उसके पहले पहाड़ी से हो चुका था, जाट से हो चुका था. तो मैं सिर्फ यह कह रहा हूँ कि विश्वविद्यालय अब अपनी यह भूमिका निभाने में बिल्कुल उनकी दिलचस्पी नहीं है, और उनके शिक्षक भी उन विभेदों को और गहरा करने में उनकी दिलचस्पी है, उनको ख़त्म करने में नहीं, क्योंकि वो ताकत वहीं से हासिल कर रहे हैं. मैं अपनी ताकत अब साहित्य से हासिल नहीं कर रहा हूँ, मैं अपनी ताकत हासिल कर रहा हूँ अपने जातीय समूह से या अपने राजनीतिक समूह से. तो फिर विश्वविद्यालय की भूमिका क्या है बड़ी, और खुद मेरी अपनी पहचान क्या है? यह मैं प्रायः हर जगह होते हुए देख रहा हूँ, इसलिए दिल्ली विश्वविद्यालय, जवाहरलाल नेहरू विश्वविद्यालय को कल तक ऐसा लगता था कि वे तो श्रेष्ठता के द्वीप हैं और बचे रहेंगे, राज्य के विश्वविद्यालयों में जो आग लगी हुई है वो उन तक नहीं पहुंचेगी, लेकिन अब इत्तेफाक से वो उसके चपेट में आ गए हैं। और अगर आपको भारतीय शिक्षा व्यवस्था के बारे में जानना हो तो श्रीलाल शुक्ल के राग दरबारी से बेहतर और कोई उपन्यास नहीं होगा। और मैं जब दिल्ली विश्वविद्यालय पहुंचा तो मैंने कहा कि छंगामल विश्वविद्यालय महाविद्यालय तो दरअसल दिल्ली विश्वविद्यालय में, आप सत्यवती कॉलेज चले जाएं, आप श्रद्धानंद कॉलेज चले जाएं, कहीं भी चले जाएं। तो
यस मैम, यू कैन वी गेट द माइक टू द लेडी, कैन वी गेट द माइक, आई थिंक मैम यू कैन स्पीक, वी विल बी एबल टू हियर यू। यस
higher education is actual quest for knowledge, and employability something brings something commercial side of it. And I have an observation as a teacher that, you know, when you don't let the students think, you do not let them think, just they wrote and they produce, they don't grow. Most of our students, when they go abroad, they're surprised to see that how much study they have to do themselves. Not that like we dictate, and I mean, I have a word for that we give pravachan and they just listen there and take notes or something. And but the thing is, if the students don't ask questions, the teachers don't grow. Only because we have that's the advantage. We are always with young people, so we always get ideas from their young minds. So that's our, if they don't learn to think, then we don't grow. We become clerical.
Fair enough.
The question is very simple. Why is it that we do not have in India a GRE, an SAT type of test? Students are coming from a variety of backgrounds, from a variety of institutions, and how can people assess whether the student is good or bad? I mean, this is what is there in practically every country in the world. You have some kind of a test in order to evaluate a student. They may be good or bad. The test may be good or bad. But why hasn't the system brought this out? Either a private sector or public sector, it doesn't matter.
Surprise, Suljit, because you have the, you know, that's what the JEE is, that's what the CAT is.
Yeah, we, but not for universities.
No, but there we have the high school exam. You have GATE for engineering, and you have the high school.
For all the colleges, liberal arts, whatever, right. We do not have any tests. 90% of the students are in those kind of colleges, not in your technical colleges.
Can I, so this is more complicated. I mean, I think, it's, so one way of thinking about the board exam is just that, actually, right? In other systems, the need for a national test was because you allowed diversity in every respect. So you're looking for something that allows a degree of commensuration, right? Now, functionally, that's what the board exam does for us. Now, there are diverse boards, but for a broad set of things, you can say, look, now, we can argue about the content of the board exams. We can argue about, you know, what does 99 in CBSE actually tell you about somebody's math ability? But functionally, in a way, that board exam is actually performing that function. I mean, I think it's a bit of an illusion to say that we actually don't have that. We have that, right? US has SAT, but it doesn't have a standardized test thing otherwise. So functionally, we have the same device.
Then you have the Bombay University exam, you have the Delhi University exam, you have CBSE. How does one, if you are an admissions committee, and if you are a national sort of system, how does somebody evaluate how somebody from Bihar is, or how somebody from Calcutta is, or how somebody from...
Commensuration.
Yeah.
Actually, it also has to do with the question which Pratap you raised earlier, which was, who has the right to decide? So I think the institutions today and the students are locked into some kind of a structure where it's actually a system which seems to be deciding. When the fact is, the students should be able to decide which institution, as much as the institution should be able to decide which students do I want. Now, if we can, what it does is it then helps institutions to develop their own area of expertise, direction, this nuanced way of providing education, and also experimentation. I mean, hundreds of institutions might be doing philosophy in a kind of slightly different way, or an engineering in slightly different way. And which then means that I must have all other parameters to look at the student other than just a standardized test. In fact, standardized tests have been critiqued very strongly for two reasons. One is, in our country, the people who make those standardized tests, which is the faculty, have no expertise in making those tests. And number two, that it actually, there's no wisdom that it is judging in those tests. It's very mechanical, and hence it's turning out to be a poor indicator of many other things that we want to do.
So there are a couple of things as well here, right? So one is, of course, standardized test for what purpose? What are you trying to sort out? Are you trying to sort out the top 0.1% from the rest? Are you trying to judge average competence? So a lot of the design issues are about that kind of test, right? But here's the fundamental paradox, right? Which is the American system gives institutions the widest latitude in deciding their students, right? And sometimes that latitude does good things, which is their ability to pick out quirky geniuses who've not done the thing, done the test right, who have some special gift, or their ability to pick out genius alumni kids, or their ability to pick out, intuit something about their bank accounts. All of that is very much a socially accepted part of that, because the fundamental premise they've been granted is, look, you are an institution, we assume you have a stake in your reputation, and you have a broad way of constructing your identity. So if a St. John's College wants to say, we will teach only classics and nothing else, and people will come to it, you're allowed to do that, right? So I think when we're talking about this testing thing, we have to see it in the totality of, in a sense, those relationships. I mean, right, in our case, the entire purpose of testing is to basically say we want to remove judgment and discretion from any educator, right? Which will lead to very different kinds of tests.
Just to give you a sense of how the debate in the US has actually changed a lot. How did the SAT actually come into being? In the 1930s, it was first launched in the US. Very few universities took it up. Then World War II comes, and Conant, who is the president of Sir Harvard, is called by Roosevelt and asked, what is Harvard going to do to help the US in the war? Now, Conant sort of realizes that the way they choose students is the elite from the banker's kids, who are not going to really have the chops in science and what you need. So he puts his weight to see that, look, he realizes that there might be bright kids who are farmers' sons in Iowa, and we need some standard test to be able to pick them out. So they put their weight behind that exam, and that's how it becomes. Fast forward 60, 70 years later, what has happened, what one of the reasons that inequality has been reproduced in higher education, not the only reason, is that all standardized tests, over time, you get a coaching industry. The coaching industry means those whose parents are richer can send their kids to better coaching places, and they can, standardized tests is, there are techniques, you have exposure, and you can definitely increase your thing, which in our country is quota is a good example. So what over time what standardized tests have tended to do is they tend to discriminate against poorer children and poorer, because they will never have the ability to go to any of the coaching institutions, which is almost de rigueur. this is, I know you have more, but why don't we take a few other things and we'll come back to it.
Finding the right requisite talent, which will fill the seats, etc. And they have their own sort of training programs for 3 months, 4 months, which sort of somehow fit in and sort of can equip the person coming in to deal with the job. So they take a person who studied for 3 years who supposedly should have that knowledge, retrain them again for another 3-4 months, and sort of render the previous. It's obviously useful, but for their use, the previous education is sort of somewhere rendered useless. Now my question is that where do you see the in this ideal sort of university that you're speaking about, how should it look like? Do you feel that there is a good role that say private corporate enterprises should play? And what do you feel that do you feel that there is any place for them to be there?
Yes, sir. So the first thing that let's hope we won't have a situation of $1 trillion student loan debt. But considering Professor Kapoor's pessimism on the future of the public institution, I just really wanted to know what would you consider to be some low-hanging fruit that we could probably work upon through research, through activism, through anything that would stem this decay that our public universities seem to be really falling into?
Go ahead, madam.
Hi. My question is regarding the role of regulators, which I think was brought about in the initial parts of the conversation. And where do you think should the control in governance and regulation in higher education lie, center or state? As you mentioned, sir, in West Bengal, the act has changed. I have been researching about Maharashtra, and the most important element that goes in higher education would be probably the extent of autonomy. So the Maharashtra State Public University Act of 1964 defined autonomy as academic, financial, and administrative, which has now been revised to only academic, and this is still pending to be proposed. This has been cleared by the cabinet in the Maharashtra Assembly, and this is as of 2016 December. And this is in public domain, so I'm talking about it. How do you think, for people who are working in the sector for higher education, how difficult it is for them to navigate these issues? Because when you're trying to work in the sector, when you're trying to understand the challenges here, and such legislations are being passed, I think it becomes very difficult to bring about change that we are talking about. So where should the control in regulation and governance lie, center or state?
I can speak.
Yes, go ahead.
Good evening, everyone. It was really nice discussion. We spoke about standardization of education, or probably the test that helps in the admissions. My understanding is that only a very small amount of students are affiliated to CBSE, and a large amount are affiliated to the state boards, Bihar board, UP board, Maharashtra board, Karnataka board. So they have a difference of teaching, the quality of teaching, the number of students that they teach, the number of penetration that they have at the community level. Bring up a test which judges these students and a student who has come out of CBSE, studied in DPS, at Delhi school, and one who has studied in, Chhapra, Bihar, government school. So what do you bring? Are you against standardization in that sense, or do you want to make it a little more complex so that you can accommodate or judge these two students at their level?
I want to answer all the questions. A couple of brief thoughts. First on the regulation question. At this point, there are a couple of, and that's also your question about kind of what can we do. There's a couple of ways of looking at it. One, as Pankaj said, one of the advantages of a regulatory system that vested a lot of powers in the UGC is that in principle, if you could change the UGC, you could actually change the culture of regulation quite fast, even if you didn't get a whole bunch of other legislation through. I mean, the last government just spent so much time, you know, chasing illusory legislation and not doing the most obvious thing, which is appoint sensible regulators. I mean, that's the easiest way of getting stuff going. And in critical mass, I mean, it's not just the UGC chairman. I mean, you know, in a way, the standard. In fact, a dean of a Chinese university once told me, which is that the one thing he learned after trying to do higher education in China was, he said, any institution is only as good and will reflect the culture of the least good member of that institution, not the best. Because it's really about the ability to set standards and norms and culture, right? So at one level, I think a lot of that, you know, in fact, I've now actually come to think that the demand for legislative remedies is another large diversionary tactic. Completely misses the point. You can have all the legislative remedies you want, but if you have the appointments you have right now, it's right. So that's I think a much more important question. I mean, you could in principle, even under the system, current system, actually do, you know, in a sense, do a lot of stuff. Second thing is just clarity about what you're regulating and why you're regulating it, right? Are there differences in the kinds of entities you're regulating, this administrative distinction? Now, obviously, for a public university, how you spend taxpayers' money matters in a way in which necessarily does not matter for a private university, at least not in the same way. It does even in a private university, but not in the same way, right? So it's having a regulatory system that can actually exercise judgment, right? Lay some ground rules and then exercise judgment on the circumstances and the objectives of regulation, right? You know, the old, I mean, just to take simple things, right? I mean, this is old UGC visiting committees to public universities, which was a nice review process if you use it well. A committee comes every 5 years, engages with the university deeply, you know, assesses based on that, makes some recommendations. Now, you could use that mechanism, and the old days, by and large, those committees understood, for example, that you treat the university as a whole. You give block grants to universities. Whether they should be doing math or Sanskrit, let the university kind of figure out. We trust them enough, right? Now it's sort of micromanaged down to the, right? So the same mechanism, you can actually see its evolution depending on the people that were appointed, right? So my own sense is that I think a lot of the conversation needs to move at that level. And as Devesh said and Pankaj said, you know, education is 95% about presumptive trust in people. If you lose that, I mean, sometimes you have to hold your noses. I mean, there will be a few laggards. I mean, you know, when there are 100 flowers, there will be a few weeds. But we use the weeds as a pretext to basically kill off all the flowers. I mean, the whole philosophy has to change. It's not so much about, you know, what the formal structure is.
So just adding to what Pratap just said, my position is, I think we've had enough regulation and we've seen the consequences of it. I've worked in public institutions throughout. I've led public institutions and I'm now in a private institution. I think I want to move this pendulum on the other side and experiment. Now, having said that, there are four things that an institution from the which the regulator controls that affects institutions directly. One is admissions, which is about the choice. Second is about fees. And that one can have a very large debate in the country and many other mechanisms because that directly impacts access. The third is about curriculum. And that, once again, is about choice to the institutions. And fourth is about who is going to become a faculty or who's going to lead and so on and so forth. That's again by choice. So if at the end of the day, it really boils down to that one question. At an institution, who chooses? And if you believe that the institutions must choose, then there is no regulation.
OK,
Can I just one more sentence on this? Sorry to go on about this, but I think it was implicit in what Apurvanand said, but I think it has to be part of the regulatory debate, basically. Autonomy, the autonomy debate has come to mean autonomy for the university's vice chancellor, yeah. Right? The autonomy debate has to be a debate about what is the allocation of authority within the university as well, right? Mm-hmm. A lot of these conflicts, right, for example, over syllabi, right, these winner takes all conflicts, right? Did that book get in the syllabus or not? Would be easily mitigated or much easier to mitigate technically in universities where professors make their own syllabus and grade their own students. Harder to mitigate in systems where you have to do standardized exams for 100,000 students, right? So that part of the conversation, right, should departments be able to define their identities, right, in relation to disciplinary methods, you know, right? That debate also has to be opened up. I mean, I think, and in fact, a lot of the reasons the regulator steps in is because we haven't resolved that at the university level. So all of us, the first thing we do is go and appeal to the UGC and say, please sort out our disputes.
तो इसको मैं एक दूसरे ढंग से देखना चाहूँगा प्रताप की बात बिल्कुल ठीक है कि अगर आप autonomy की बात करते हैं तो उसका मतलब ये नहीं है कि वो autonomy पूरी तरह से वाइस चांसलर में वेस्ट करेगी बल्कि वो autonomy नीचे तक जाएगी डीन और हेड्स और डिपार्टमेंट्स फैकल्टी इन सब में जाएगी मुझे लगता है मैं दिल्ली यूनिवर्सिटी का सिस्टम देखता हूँ या दूसरे तो उनको डिज़ाइन इस तरह से किया गया है कि यह मानकर कि उनकी autonomy है लेकिन वो autonomy खुद से सबने वाइस चांसलर के हवाले कर दी और उनको एक्सरसाइज नहीं किया ये मुझे सबसे दिलचस्प ढंग से दिखलाई पड़ा फोर ईयर अंडरग्रेड प्रोग्राम के बहस के दौरान जब ये बिल्कुल हाथ में था फैकल्टी के डिपार्टमेंट्स के कि वो कहें कि हम इस स्ट्रक्चर को डिस्कस करेंगे लेकिन डीन फैकल्टी डिपार्टमेंट हेड्स ने कहा कि जो स्ट्रक्चर हमें वाइस चांसलर ने दिया है उसको मानना हमारा फ़र्ज़ है उस पर बहस कराना हमारा काम नहीं है कंसल्टेशन हमारा काम नहीं है एक दूसरे की ऑटोनॉमी की पूरी बहस में जब हम यशपाल कमेटी में काम कर रहे थे तो सरकार की तरफ से कहा गया कि ऑटोनॉमी अर्न करनी पड़ती है ये बार बार सरकार के सेक्रेटरीज ने कहा और प्रोफेसर यशपाल का कहना था कि ऑटोनॉमी प्री कंडीशन होगी क्वालिटी की आप ये नहीं कर सकते कि आप कहें कि आप ऑटोनॉमी अर्न कीजिए बल्कि आपको ऑटोनॉमी देनी पड़ेगी और ये रिस्क है तो ठीक है रिस्क है जैसा इन्होंने कहा कि 100 फूल खिलेंगे उसमें कुछ घास पतवार भी आएगा तो आप उसे देखिए लेकिन यह अविश्वास भारत के विश्वविद्यालयों पर और स्टैंडर्डाइजेशन की चाह जो एक सवाल में यहाँ उठी हर स्तर पर टेस्टिंग हर स्तर पर स्टैंडर्डाइजेशन और उस वजह से अब यूजीसी इस हालत में है और MHRD कि वो जैसा मैंने शुरू में कहा कि वह अब किसी यूनिवर्सिटी पे भरोसा करने को तैयार नहीं है कि आप अपना सिलेबस बना सकते हैं तो अगर हम अपना सिलेबस बना ही नहीं सकते तो स्टूडेंट यहाँ पढ़ने क्यों आ रहा है उसको हम पे क्यों भरोसा होना चाहिए जब रेगुलेटर को ही भरोसा नहीं है हमारी बुद्धि पर तो छात्र को क्यों भरोसा होना चाहिए इसलिए ऑटोनॉमी एक फंडामेंटल प्रिंसिपल है जिस पर यकीन किया जाना चाहिए और जैसा प्रताप ने कहा कि अब उस पर और बहस होने की ज़रूरत है कि वह अलग अलग स्तरों में कैसे जाएगी
I think you raised the question of what are the low-hanging fruits, if there are. So I'll just use sort of two sayings. One is, you know, Napoleon had this saying, there are no bad soldiers, only bad generals. If your vice chancellors are useless, it is very hard to think you're going to get a great universities. And the way we choose, forget vice chancellor, the UGC chairman and the vice chancellors, is actually have absolutely useless people in a large number of institutions. Once you have that in place, it's very hard to change things. It is just not going to happen. So one thing, which is the second saying, personnel is policy. You want policy change, begin with personnel. Just if you pick reasonable vice chancellors, you have already progressed, you're on your way to begin to change things. But if you insist on choosing people who have ideological or other or have paid off money or all sorts of other, the chances of change are frankly going to be non-existent. Having said that, slight variation of what Apurvanand said, you know, many faculty don't want autonomy. I mean, look at the debate which happened in St. Stephen's, you know, which was, you know, which is, I've talked to many faculty in Delhi University, and I was surprised they don't want autonomy, because autonomy means now they have to prepare their own syllabus, which is actually work, by the way. You know, pedagogy is not easy when I have to do it on my own. As long as I'm getting a list that I'm going to now just regurgitate, I go home, my salary is coming from somewhere else. I don't want that. Actually, it's a lot of work, autonomy, which many faculty simply don't want. I've been amazed at how many faculty in Delhi colleges who I've talked to vehemently oppose autonomy for their institutions, because that means there's no centralized syllabus. You have to think of your pedagogy. You have to apply your own mind. You just can't come and mechanically do this stuff. It's a two-way street.
थोड़ा मेरा मतभेद है दिवेश से, खासकर इसलिए कि उन्होंने स्टीवेंस का नाम लिया. मुझे लगता है वो बहस, मैं उस बहस में नहीं जा रहा हूँ, वह ज़्यादा पेचीदा है. वह सिर्फ यह मामला नहीं है कि अध्यापक आलसी हैं और वो खुद अपने करिकुलम और सिलेबस पे काम नहीं करना चाहते, उन्हें कोई बना कर दे दे और काम कर लेंगे. उनकी आशंकाएँ दूसरी हैं, और भारत में जिस तरह सरकारें काम करती हैं उनकी आशंकाएँ बेजा नहीं हैं. इसलिए कि आप हिंदुस्तान के किसी भी वाइस चांसलर से पूछिए कि अगर वह कहीं से पैसा ले आए अपनी यूनिवर्सिटी के लिए, इसके लिए इंसेंटिव क्या है और इसका दंड उसे कैसे भुगतना पड़ता है. यानी उसे जो फंड यूजीसी दे रही है उस फंड से कितनी कटौती हो जाएगी अगर वो पैसा ला रहा है. तो ऑटोनॉमी में जो आशंका है शिक्षकों की, वही है कि आप ऑटोनॉमी कह रहे हैं, उसके बाद आप धीरे धीरे ये कह रहे हैं उस संस्था को कि आप अपना पैसा खुद उगाहें. और जब आप अपना पैसा खुद उगाहें तो शिक्षकों के साथ जो शर्तें होंगी इनकी सेवा की, वो भी आप तय करें. इन आशंकाओं को आप नज़रअंदाज कर दें और ये कह दें कि शिक्षक आलसी हैं इसलिए वो लेना नहीं चाहते हैं, तो ये कुछ नाइंसाफी है. देखिए
अभी भी लगते हैं.
आत्महत्या करने वाला ऐसे सॉफ्टवेयर के लेवल में जब ऑटोनॉमी वाला जो इशू आया कि क्या बात थी कि उसको बायो पेशे कर दी कि एक महीना आप वीसी के आप ऑफिस दौड़ भाग कीजिए, आप आपका क्रेडिट जो क्रेडिट होता है 19 के 8 के आसपास ये था, तो फिर भी वीसी ने तो कुछ सुना नहीं. एक महीने के बाद जब सुना तो कहते आप मेरे बेटे जैसे. मैंने कहा सर मुझे एक महीना तक ये बात बताने के लिए डिपार्टमेंट कैसा है, प्रोफेसर कैसे हैं और मेरे मार्क्स के बारे में कुछ नहीं है. मुझे मेरे बस मेरे जो ऑटोनॉमी वाला इशू था कि मैं अपने ग्रीवेंसेस में किसके पास एड्रेस करूँ, कौन सुनेगा मेरी. तो ये इशू बीसी और हमारे एचओडी पुणे यूनिवर्सिटी के थे, वो कभी समझ नहीं पाए. एक महीना लग गया, वो हो गया. उसके बाद में मुझे पॉलिटिकली मुझे सपोर्ट देना पड़ा सभी पार्टीज का, और मैंने सभी को कहा कि भैया मैं अगर आप यहाँ पे ये चाहते हो सिर्फ मेरा ही न्याय नहीं है, बाकी और भी बहुत लोग हैं जिन्हें न्याय चाहिए, क्योंकि यहाँ पे मेंटर और ट्यूटर का डिबेट हो रहा है. अगर मैं ट्यूटर हायर कर रहा हूँ और यहाँ पे यूनिवर्सिटीज में ट्यूटर्स हैं, मेंटर नहीं है, और यही स्थिति हमारे देश की है. जिस प्रकार से जैसे उन्होंने बताया झा जी ने कि ये कैंपसेस हैं, ये कैंपसेस एक इतना ज़्यादा अभी वाइब्रेंट हो चुका है. JNU वाइब्रेंट है, DU वाइब्रेंट है, कुछ और यूनिवर्सिटीज ज़्यादा तो इम्पॉर्टेंस है, बाकी यूनिवर्सिटीज तो सोई हुई हैं. और इशू अब मेन चीज में आ रहा हूँ इस चीज़ में कि ये जो कॉलेजेस हैं, मुझे 2 साल पहले फोन आया एक व्यक्ति का, मेडिकल कॉलेज बेचना है, खरीदना है क्या. तमिलनाडु का कॉलेज था, मैंने कहा भैया मैं उसको रिस्ट्रक्चर कर सकता हूँ, अभी मैं खरीद नहीं सकता. फिर वैसे ही एक दिन एक व्यक्ति हमारा एक प्रोजेक्ट था औरंगाबाद महाराष्ट्र में गौशाला के पास में, एक आया उनका मैं 10th पास आउट हूँ. मैंने स्कूल शुरू किया इंटरनेशनल स्कूल, मैंने कहा भैया ये स्टैंडर्डाइज में तो कैसा है. नहीं बोले यहाँ पे कोई भी शुरू कर सकता है इंटरनेशनल स्कूल, हम कोई भी शुरू कर सकते हैं. महाराष्ट्र से लेकर के साउथ में जितने भी जो बड़े बड़े जो व्यक्ति हैं बिजनेस हाउसेस हैं, इन लोगों ने खुद के इंस्टीट्यूट खुद के इंस्टीट्यूशंस बड़े बड़े इवन यूनिवर्सिटीज भी खुद की है. तो फिर डिज़ाइन कौन करेगा कोर्स, करिकुलम कौन, और कौन किसे हायर करेगा, और उसका स्टैंडर्ड कितना होगा, ये कोई डिसाइड नहीं कर पाएगा.
ये मार्केट पूरा हो चुका है.
Thank you, thank you. Go ahead. I'll request you to keep your questions short, please.
I will be very short. One, I wanted to say thank you for giving me a chance to contribute to this work. I've learned so much by just working with you guys. But I had one very stark thing that there appeared to be in this whole conversation, where there was no mention of the student, other than one mention that you made around, you know, the demand side not worrying you. I actually live with the demand side. I work in small town India. And a couple of things. One, you're dealing with a very cynical 18-year-old. I deal with very cynical 18-year-olds. I've had people where I've sat and told them the story of perhaps, you know, idealistic stories, maybe shared my own stories. I've had an 18-year-old boy look at me into my eye and say, I feel like you're lying to me. How do I believe everything you're saying? Maybe this, I feel like, ma'am, I feel like this whole thing you've played out is a movie. I don't believe anything you're saying. That's one. Two, you know, Apurvanand, you've been talking about the role of a teacher, and I feel like one very gigantic thing I see is that liberal arts as a concept is dying. The towns I work in, a BA student is called, in their words, kachra or kura, and these are realities which I confront on a day-to-day basis. I'm just surprised that as a conversation we did not touch upon the student, access to awareness, access to information, asymmetrical information. These are all very
real stark
facts. We as a country have to take on.
One more. Yes, go ahead, ma'am.
Just to experience some basically and how they can do this higher education level. One of the questions which have been raised about Stanford is entry to university, whether there should be a standardized test or not that. For example, if we take the example of Delhi University, now because all the boards, their way of assessment is totally different. So how do you standardize the admission process? For instance, in Delhi University, they said that SRCC this year had students who were from one particular school in Tamil Nadu who filled the entire SRCC slot. So that's because they all had 99% or something. But there is no standardization of a student who's coming from Bihar or who's coming from CBSE or who's coming from some other board. How do you resolve that? The second issue is also based on some on an experience, basically, the over-standardization of our curriculums. I know somebody who was brilliant in maths, had done economics, but Delhi University went right up to the vice chancellor and she said, take a test. I'm willing to write a test, but give me admission in master's mathematics. They said, no, you've done one paper short, so you cannot get it. Now that girl, later on in the US, she not only got admission in mathematics in master's, she also got teaching assistantship, although she had not done it at the graduation. So those are also issues, I think, which we need to resolve. There should be some ways of, and she's a brilliant student, so we've actually lost a brilliant student from India.
I think we'll have to wrap it up, but I'll just give all of your final comments to address the remark on the lack of students.
Still, yeah. The last thing, if you ask, could like Ramanujan get admitted to a good college in India today? I'll just leave it sort of at that. And that sort of captures the tragedy of what we've done.
Yeah, I think you raised exactly the right question, and I think the worst thing is getting them the experience of the system, whether it'll make them even more cynical. I mean, I think one of the earlier, we used to have this line that, you know, I mean, if we have great universities, we can build a great India. If we don't have any universities, we might still be okay. But if we have bad universities, you're really sitting on a social time bomb because it's producing a very different kind of mismatch. And that's, you know, that's the level at which it needs to be engaged.
Well, couldn't have agreed with you more. But I give you a point of hope. I deal with undergrads, and I, after a long time dealing with undergrads, and I must say, and these come from a full distribution of the society, so this is not an elitist institution. I must say, I've never seen 17-year-olds who are so fabulous and so excited, and that's actually many of our motivation here to really fight this issue and remain engaged to create institutions that matter.
पंकज से सहमत होते हुए कि आज से 6 साल पहले जब रामानुजन का लेख दिल्ली विश्वविद्यालय ने हटाया तब तकरीबन 3,000 छात्र सड़क पर आ गए, और ये सब छात्र ऐसा नहीं था कि दिल्ली के अंग्रेज़ी स्कूलों से पढ़े हुए थे, बिहार, उत्तर प्रदेश, मध्य प्रदेश, छोटी जगहों से आए हुए थे। और इस बार भी जब रामजस कॉलेज में यह घटना हुई तो दिल्ली विश्वविद्यालय की सड़क पर 5,000 छात्र थे। तो मैं इतना निराश नहीं हूँ, लेकिन मैं इस बात से पूरी तरह सहमत हूँ कि एक बहुत बड़ी खाई राज्यों के कॉलेजेस और विश्वविद्यालय और केंद्रीय विश्वविद्यालयों के बीच में है, और उस खाई की अनदेखी करना बहुत खतरनाक है। तीसरी चीज़ जिसके बारे में आप कह रही थी कि पिछले कुछ वर्षों में नॉलेज नाम के एंटरप्राइज को लेकर इतना ज़्यादा शक पैदा किया गया है और इतनी नफरत पैदा की गई है कि ये गलत चीज़ हो रही है देश के साथ, और काम की चीज़ करनी है, यानी कैसे पेट भरा जाए। तो ये जो यानी मैं आपको सिर्फ ये पूछना चाहूँगा कि पिछले 3 वर्षों में इस सरकार के जो नीति संबंधी दस्तावेज हैं या जो भाषण होते हैं उसमें एक शब्द आप खोज के निकाल दीजिए, हिंदी में जिसको ज्ञान कहते हैं, अंग्रेजी में नॉलेज, मुझे इस शब्द का उच्चारण इस सरकार में कहीं भी नहीं दिखलाई पड़ा। इतनी उदासीनता और नफरत जब नॉलेज से हो तो फिर उसका क्या होगा। मैं सिर्फ ये कह रहा हूँ कि इस पर हमने काफ़ी बात की नहीं है।
Should we wrap it up? Thank you.
Thank you, Anubhav, particularly.